Well, I love to watch baptisms. I think I could watch baptisms all day long and to hear stories of transformation, how God is at work is just incredible to see. I want to welcome all the campuses. This is a special weekend, and I love that video recapping Wake Up Conference last week. And just it's so cool just to see how God is on the move and what it is that he's doing. And I will tell you this, since it is a baptism weekend, just know that if God's working on your heart and making that commitment to be obedient to God's command, whether it's from something from Wake Up Conference, whether it's something that's just taking place in your own life, we want to celebrate that decision and that significant benchmark in your life. So don't put that off. We started a brand new sub-series this weekend of our series, Just Jesus. We're continuing our walk through the Gospel of Mark, and we're starting to call this next section a radical teacher, because that's exactly who Jesus was and who he is. And the teaching of Jesus broke the social norms of his time on the earth, and religious leaders of the day found his teachings to be so radical, and his teaching continues to radically change people's lives each and every day. He was a rabbi who spoke with authority. He had a new twist on things that people were not accustomed to. So what I want to encourage you to do is I want you to take out your Bible or your mobile device, and I want you to turn to Mark chapter 7 and just hold on to that. We're going to cover a lengthy passage of Scripture today, and we want to just dial in and see exactly what it is that God has for us. Now, Jesus has had a steady diet of teaching and healing. And in the midst of the disciples learning of the brutal beheading of John the Baptist, Jesus' cousin, they have been grief-stricken. They've tried to pull away and go to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, but the paparazzi spilled the beans and the crowds came by the thousands. And Jesus had compassion on them and he taught them, and miraculously, he fed them. He fed all of them. Last week, the campus pastors did a great job of teaching us on how we can make it through the storms of life. The struggles have a purpose, and we aren't alone. And Jesus is with us during those tough times of life. He is sovereign over your storm that you're encountering. And so now we come to Mark chapter 7, and Jesus has to be tired from the busyness. And it begins in this opening verses with these leaders, the Pharisees, trying to trap Jesus with petty religious arguments over human traditions. And Jesus has been caring for so many hurting people. He's been miraculously healing the sick, miraculously multiplying meals. But the religious leaders don't come to him celebrating this incredible work that he's done. Instead, they come and they want to argue with him about traditions. Now, from the outset, let's understand that the traditions are not good and they're not bad. They're neutral. Some can be very significant to us. We all have traditions that are very important to us. Habits that over time, they kind of become ingrained, that they become a part of our normal routine. And you can try to think of some. You probably have some within your own family structure. When you were growing up, you can think of some traditions that were incredibly important to your family. There are some homes that I go to, and when I go to that home, I see that there are shoes that are right there at the doorway area. And what does that subtly tell me? When I see a whole bunch of pairs of shoes right there, it's like, oh, I think they must have new carpet. I better take my shoes off. They don't want me walking all around with my shoes on, right? So that's just a tradition that some people have. Some of you grew up in a home where there was one room that you weren't allowed to walk in because it was for guests. It was for people that were there for some special occasion. Maybe it's a family tradition. Maybe it's an annual summer vacation that you always went on. I'm thinking of a tradition that we have in our home. I grew up in Cincinnati. My wife, all of our kids were born in Kentucky. And when I drive 2 hours north to Cincinnati, and when I come around in northern Kentucky, there's a cut in the hill there, and you come around and all of a sudden you see the sprawling skyline of Cincinnati. Now, it's not a Chicago skyline, all right? Okay? But it's a nice skyline. And I always say the same thing to my family. I say, most beautiful sight in the world. And they just laugh at me because they are not that crazy about Cincinnati and they like Kentucky. And so now whenever I'm riding with them or if one of them is up there, they'll take a picture of it and they'll send it to me. They'll say, most beautiful sight in the world. They don't mean it, all right? They just are carrying on the tradition. Now, there are other things you can think of. Maybe it's something that's done at Christmas at your house, or maybe it's Thanksgiving. You know, your whole family travels to grandma's house for Thanksgiving dinner. You say, oh, that's not a tradition. That's more of an option, or that's more of a suggestion. Well, when you get married, and on Thanksgiving, you say to your family, hey, we're going to the in-laws. I'm going to her parents for Thanksgiving. You tell me then if it's a suggestion or a preference, all right? Because that's when you start to find out, hey, this is a tradition, and it might seem like it's non-negotiable. Well, in the church, we have some traditions that are meaningful. They might not be straight from the Bible, but they're meaningful. Maybe you grew up in a church where the very last song that would be sung would be the doxology. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Or maybe it was blessed be the tie that binds. Church I grew up in, they sang that at the end of every single service. And there's little things that I've got a buddy of mine that when he started preaching, he was in a small church. And this church, they had this habit of every single week, they would, in the middle of the service, they would sing happy birthday. And they would sing the happy birthday song. And finally, he said to them in an elders meeting, he said, hey, you know, we only have 40 people in the church. And you all sing the song, happy birthday. And then after the song, you say, is there anyone who is having their birthday today? And then they come up and they put an offering in a little church that had a little steeple on it. And they put some coins in there. And he said, but most of the time, 8 out of 9 weeks, there's nobody that had a birthday that day. So he said, why don't, before we sing the song, why don't we ask if anybody has their birthday today? And they thought about it, and they voted, and unanimously they voted not to do that. And they went against the kid's suggestion because they said, no, this is how we've always done it. And they didn't want to change the worship service that was so sacred. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, how did they sing happy birthday if they didn't have a name in there? Many of you know the answer to that. The last line goes, happy birthday, God bless you. And that's how they covered it. Okay, let's get back. Now, all that sounds kind of silly and archaic when you think of traditions within the church, but I might encourage you when you come to church to bring your Bible, and I might prefer that you bring your Bible with you rather than looking up a passage in your mobile phone. Now, that's not scriptural. I don't have anything to stand on when it comes to that. That's just a preference that I have. But when I have that preference, it comes out of the fact that I like to mark things in my Bible. I like to highlight my Bible in different ways. And I say all of that to my 25-year-old son, and my 25-year-old son looks back at me and says, Dad, I can do every one of those things that you just said right on my mobile device. He said, I can highlight my scriptures. He said, I can color code them. I can underline things. I can have verses sent to me to help me memorize them through the course of the day. And he goes through about 10 different things. And he said, and you know what else? He said, wherever I am, I always have my Bible with me. So I can dig in and make a human tradition something that's more important than it really is. But as a parent, you know what really matters to me? That my son, that my daughter is opening up God's word, whether it's on canvas, whether it's on leather, whether it's digital. And that's the big thing. You see, it's easy for us to get pulled aside by human traditions, and we're going to see that as the Pharisees tend to major in minors. We're going to see three different observations here in Mark chapter 7. Here's the first observation. There are large implications from the small differences between biblical truth and man-made traditions. This is a more serious topic than perhaps the opening stories that I shared may have indicated. Look in Mark chapter 7, verses 1 through 4. Now when the Pharisees gathered to him, that's talking about Jesus, with some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem, they saw that some of his disciples ate with hands that were defiled, that is, unwashed. For the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they wash their hands properly, holding to the tradition of the elders when they come from the marketplace. They do not eat unless they wash. And there are many other traditions that they observe, such as the washing of cups and pots and copper vessels and dining couches. So the key phrase for you to notice here is this phrase that says, is holding on to the tradition of the elders. This wasn't scripture. These were traditions that people had added to. There were some rules and some commands in the Old Testament that might seem strange when it comes to doing things ceremonially, but they were more understood in that culture in those times. But over the course of time, there were different elders or different spiritual leaders who had added on, and they wanted things to be a little bit more stringent, a little bit more taxing. And so these Pharisees must have been watching Jesus and the disciples as it came time for them to eat. They'd been there for some time. They pulled out their lunch pails, and as they dive into their food, the Pharisees finally find something that they can catch Jesus with. The fact that his followers did not ceremonially wash their hands. How they would have done it, according to this tradition, was they would have taken a pitcher of water, they would have poured it over one hand, and then they would have poured another pitcher over the other hand, and they would have cleaned them separately. That's what they're talking about here. So this goes beyond just, you know, hey, wash your hands before it's dinner time, okay? They're not concerned. There was not a coronavirus that was roaming around at this time. What they were concerned about was that they were discounting the value of these spiritual traditions that they held to be so important. So look here at, first of all, the definition of what a tradition is. And we could say that traditions are, it's any kind of teaching, spoken or written, handed down from generation to generation. Such as in this context, it's really an add-on. It's something on top of what the Old Testament scriptures taught back in the Pentateuch. And it's an adding on of the method of washing cups and pitchers and kettles in a certain way. Now, the Pharisees' concern wasn't driven out of concern for someone getting sick. It wasn't driven out of a concern for cleanliness. It was more of this ceremonial act. And they see Jesus and the 12 people who are teaching spiritual truths to large crowds, and they want to add an extra layer of what they equated with spirituality. So in other words, they're saying, you're not as spiritual as we are, because you don't have people doing the ceremonial cleaning. Here's the second part I want you to see. I want you to see how we describe or define truth. It's a simpler definition. Truth is the Word of God. It's the Word of God. In the context of this discussion, nothing more, nothing less, it's God's Word. It's powerful, sharper than any double-edged sword. This is a book that will never return void. So we must be careful not to give more weight or credence to a tradition that is not scriptural. For example, I have a number of friends who go to churches that choose not to use instrumental music in their worship services. And if they say that's a tradition that they choose to observe, but they don't condemn other churches that use an instrument, then I'm fine with that. If that's their preference, then that's awesome. Where I start to have a problem, in my opinion, is if they say that according to scripture, you should not be using an instrument. Well, then I would have a problem with that, because I think that they are making a tradition into a truth, and I would disagree with that. Here's the second part of this, the accusation of the Jews. They're going to come at Jesus full barrel, and they're going to try to catch him on this. Look in your Bible at verse 5. And the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, "Why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but they eat with defiled hands?" In other words, why do they break this tradition? Why don't they wash their hands? And Jesus has to be thinking, really? I mean, I have been working incredible miracles helping change lives one life at a time in dramatic fashion. And this is what the religious people are going to come and focus on. People are being healed. People's lives are being changed. And they're upset because of the tradition of hand washing is being overlooked at times. That seems crazy, doesn't it? My first ministry that I ever had, I was a student minister. And I loved it. I still love working with kids. And I was at a church in Louisville, not the church where I was for the last 30 years, but I was at a different church on the other side of town. And I was a student minister there. And I'll never forget one fall, we had a big retreat, kind of like the Wake Up Conference that was here last week. And we had around 60 junior high and high school kids that went on this retreat. And we had this incredible time together, 2 days, 48 hours of teaching God's word and playing together and worshiping together. And they came not knowing what I had planned, but part of what we did that weekend, and these were fringe kids, a lot of them. Many of them came at the invitation of someone else, and many of them didn't know much about the Bible. But I preached from the Sermon on the Mount in all the different sessions, and so throughout this 48 hours, we worked on memorizing 9 verses, an entire passage from the Sermon on the Mount. And we all got in a bus. We came back to the church on Sunday nights, and there was a worship service there, and we turned it into a youth night, and kids gave testimonies. I preached a sermon, and then the last thing I did was I had all 60 of them come up on the stage. And I said, they have a gift that they would like to give to you all as a church family and as their own parents and siblings. And together, these 60 kids quoted off verbatim with power and authority 9 consecutive verses. And I'm telling you what, it might sound crazy to you, but it was just an electric moment. It was just one of those moments where, I mean, it was like the whole church felt so good about the future. And we closed with prayer. We were just flying high. I went to the back door to shake hands as everybody left, and people were so encouraging, and everybody was all smiles. But an older couple came up to me, and I remember it like it was yesterday. And they just verbally began to rip me to shreds. And you say, what in the world would cause someone to do that? I'll never forget, because I just remember the lobby area had been buzzing with activity and laughter and fun. And these two were so loud in their words to me that the entire room got quiet. Do you know what they were upset about? Do you know why they threatened to leave the church? It was because I had the students memorize the 9 verses out of a translation that wasn't the King James Version. And in a matter of seconds, I felt like I went from the mountain to the valley. They said only a pagan would have them read from a Bible. It wasn't the true Bible. Their words, not mine. And I at first thought they were joking, and I tried to joke back. They weren't joking. That was one of my first times to be exposed to someone overdosing on human tradition. But it was not my last. And if we aren't careful, we can add expectations that are based on human tradition or personal preference, all under the guise of holiness and righteousness. You say, well, Dave, that's an example from 35 years ago. I mean, could you give us something more current or relevant? Okay. How about one of my first times that I ever came to Harvest to preach? And after the service was over, someone took me to task because I had a couple of scriptures in my sermon that I put on the screen that were in the New International Version. And they announced to me that that's not what the sanctuary Bibles are, and you shouldn't be using that. Okay. Really? And in my heart, with all that was going on in the life of the church at that moment, I thought, this is what you're focused on? You see, human tradition can creep in and we begin to major in minors. We can focus on our preference, our tradition, more so than God's word. We can worry about how the preacher is dressed or if the worship team looks cool enough or whether or not the translation is one that I like or they go to those movies. I can't believe they go to those movies. Or I saw one of them playing cards at their house the other day. Oh, no. Or the traditions can be built around whether your kids go to public school or Christian school or homeschool. And you will find camps and human traditions in every category. You get the idea. But how can we start to see how we can get on track rather than off track? You see, we fixate and focus on the trivial, and all the while we are oblivious to the obvious. And when we do, the end result will always be that Jesus will be angered and Jesus will be frustrated. When a church cares more about their practices than they do the people, when they're more concerned about interpretive differences than they are about intentional discipleship, when they're more concerned about keeping traditions than they are about saving souls. Here's a third area I want you to see, the explanation from Jesus. Jesus is going to have an explanation that he gives back to them. Look at verses 6 through 8. And he said to them, "Well, did Isaiah prophesy of you hypocrites, as it is written?" Now, stop right there. He says, "You hypocrites." This is the very first time that Jesus ever calls the Pharisees hypocrites. He says, is Isaiah talking about you hypocrites? He goes on and says, "As it is written," and he quotes from Isaiah, "This people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. You leave the commandment of God and hold to the tradition of men." He's saying that to them. This is a label that fits you. You leave the commandments and instead you hold to these traditions. And so Jesus quotes from the Old Testament a prophecy that they would be acquainted with. And the people were merely giving God lip service rather than a true dedication of their heart. This has resulted in the elevation of their traditions above their authentic worship and obedience to the commands of God. And Jesus is saying that what on the surface might appear to be heartfelt obedience to God, upon closer investigation, it really isn't. And what the Pharisees thought was spirituality or religiosity, in their opinion, wasn't that. In Jesus' opinion, it was actually sin. And his harshest rebukes were for the Pharisees who were seen as the spiritual leaders. So if they weren't real and transparent, and if they were just putting on an act for others in order to give people the appearance that they were holy, then they were pointing people in the exact opposite direction, and they were pointing them to a false gospel. They were blindly devoted to their traditions, and they were blind to the true intent and the weightier matters of the law. They majored in minors. They lost sight of the big picture. And the result was that their duplicity was painting an inaccurate picture of someone who was walking closely with God. They claimed to know God, but by their actions, they denied God. And let me just say that the worst advertisement for Christianity are Christians who play a role rather than being sold out to Christ. I'm convinced that the best kindling wood for the fires of hell are the logs in the eyes of Christian hypocrites. And when we worry about the speck, and all the while we have a log, there will be problems in the church. During Christ's public ministry, Jesus broke the Sabbath by working on the Sabbath several times. And the Pharisees just couldn't stand it. How dare you do work? And you know what he did for the work? He healed someone. And Jesus said, is it wrong to do good on the Sabbath? What he was trying to get is, hey, guys, you have lost the intent of all this. You are missing what is the obvious thing, the logical thing. In their quest to be religious, they were missing the point. Hugh Hollowell says it like this. He says, every time that we use religion to draw a line to keep people out, Jesus is with the people on the other side of that line. That's where he is. That's where he hangs out. That's where he wants to be. Because he wants people whose hearts are right That leads us to the second point. The second point is what you believe in your heart will shape how you behave in your life. What you believe in your heart will shape how you behave in your life. Look at Mark chapter 7, verse 9. And Jesus said to them, "You have a fine way of rejecting the commandment of God in order to establish your tradition." Now, this is 2,000 years ago, but you know sarcasm when you hear it, all right? And that's what he's saying to them. You have a fine way of rejecting the commandment of God in order to live by these traditions that you've set up. Tradition is used in this passage 5 times in the first 10 verses, and it is always contrasted with a commandment of God. In other words, it's the opposite of it, because when we start speaking on behalf of God or saying things that God didn't say, we're adding to the Bible and we're changing it. Now, in the past, there has been tension between Jesus and the religious leaders throughout the Gospel of Mark. We've seen that for the last few months. In the past, the religious leaders have always observed Jesus when he was in Jerusalem. But I want you to realize that they're outside of Jerusalem. And this chapter started with the Pharisees going somewhere to follow Jesus and to hear him so that they could trap him. So they're so concerned that now they're sending people to listen to him, to try to catch him in something. The tension has always been there, but this week in this text, when the leaders attack Jesus, Jesus does something he's not done before. This time he fights back. You see, our Savior is not some wimpy pushover. And Jesus will stand up for himself and he will stand up for God's word. And that's exactly what he does when he says, "You hypocrites." Now he goes on, and in verses 10 through 13, says, "For Moses said, 'Honor your father and your mother,'" this is Jesus speaking, "'and whoever reviles father and mother must surely die. But you say, if a man tells his father or his mother, whatever you would have gained from me is Corban, that is given to God, then you no longer permit him to do anything for his father and mother, thus making void the word of God by your tradition that you have handed down, and many such things that you do.'" Let me try to kind of explain what's going on here, because you hear that word Corban and you're like, okay, what does all this mean? Here's the simplest that I can explain this. They had a custom back then that a person, as they got older, they could make a vow with maybe their will, kind of with their estate, what they had, and they could make a vow that they were going to give what they had upon their death. They would give all of their assets to the temple. And that's all good and fine. That's great. We should do some things like that in our wills and with our estates. But the Pharisees took it a step further. And what they did was they said, "You can't touch that. Once you've made that decision, then you can't touch that money that you have and use it for some family member who's in need. You can't use it for maybe an aging parent or a handicapped relative in order to help them with their care. You can't do that," because they didn't want to give up any money that was in the treasury, the temple treasury. And so Jesus points out their flaw in their logic. He says, you make this big deal all about how, hey, you need to honor your father and mother, and yet you let your aging parents go through difficult times when you could have better care for them, because of the fact that you won't even let these people touch these dollars, because they've committed them that when they die, it's going to be for God. And so as a result of that, the Pharisees were holding families hostage when they could be helping out their family members still. Jesus says, this is just one example. And he gives the inference that I've got plenty more. You see, God's love language is obedience. You've heard me say that before. God's love language is obedience. He wants us to be obedient, but he doesn't want us to add something that isn't there. He wants to make certain that the intent of the command is being obeyed, and not just the command. And what you believe in your heart will shape how you behave in your life. And so it's so important that we get these beliefs right and that we don't add things to the scripture that aren't there. I told you about my first ministry back at that church in Louisville. It was called Shively Christian. And as I thought of that other story, my mind drifted back to one of my favorite events that we had one summer. It was in August, and I had a Bible study in my apartment at the time. And so I had 35 junior high and senior high kids that met at my house on Wednesday nights in the summer, and we had this Bible study. One night they came for Bible study, and I said to them, we're going to learn from John chapter 13, Jesus washing the feet of the disciples. And I had a 10-minute lesson on servanthood. And then I said, here's what I want you to do. I said, I want you guys to get in different carloads. And I had some different drivers that I had already handpicked. And I said, you hop in one of these cars and you go out to the city of Louisville. And for the next 2 hours, you are to be Jesus. You are just to serve people. And then I said, you come back in 2 hours from now. We're going to meet back here at my apartment. And I'm going to hear all the different stories of what every group did. Well, they loved it that I wasn't going to teach a long lesson. So they hopped out of there, very excited. They hopped in different cars. They all headed back. They came back 2 hours later. They were so excited. I said, tell me your stories. Well, one group, they said, well, we went over. One of our elders, Gratch Brown, was in the hospital, and he'd been sick. So they said, we got a get well card for him. We went over to the hospital. We went up and cheered him up, and we filled out this card, and we all signed it for him, and we prayed with him. I said, that's awesome. I said, I could see Jesus doing that. There's another group that they said, well, you know, there's a group of widows from the church that live in that apartment complex just a few blocks away from here. And right behind that apartment complex, there is a McDonald's. And so they said, you know what we did? We went and we bought 6 ice cream cones. And we went around to those 6 widows to their apartments. And we delivered melting ice cream cones. To them. I said, unbelievable. Another group said, well, you know what we did when we left? They said, when we left, we went to a nursing home. Somebody knew about a nursing home. Said, we went to this nursing home, and we went around, and we stood in every hallway, and we sang Christmas carols. And they said, it was great. Everybody was so excited, and they were excited, and they loved it. We did find out the next time we went back to that nursing home that they also confused a number of the residents because this was August. And hottest Christmas I can remember. Our group, they wanted to do yard work for somebody. And so sure enough, we went and we found a person that needed some yard work done, and we did some stuff for them. We went through all these stories, and about that time, after about half an hour, another carload came walking in. We didn't even know they weren't back. We said, you guys were supposed to be back half an hour ago. Where have you all been? They said, you're not going to believe it. Greg said, when we left the Shively Christian parking lot, we went to Shively Baptist Church. And everybody went, ooh. Because Shively Baptist was our arch rivals in church softball and in church basketball. We said, what did you do over there? They said, well, the pastor was there, and he had us do some stuff in their church library for a while. And then he said, we did that so quickly. He said, is there anything else we can do? He said, yeah. He said, we've got an elderly person that has needed to have some stuff done around their yard. We haven't been able to get anybody from our church to go over and to help them out. Would you guys mind going over and helping them out? And Greg said, we said, no problem. So we got directions. We went over there. He said, we mowed, we trimmed, we bagged, we raked, we did everything. Said, we got ready to leave. The lady was so excited. She wanted to have a prayer circle with us right there in her front yard. And one of the guys in the group, Todd, who was a football player, said, yeah, and she wanted us to all hold hands. And it was a busy street with cars going past. I said, well, how did you handle that, Todd? He said, well, I did it, but I kept my eyes open. Okay. Said, we all prayed. She prayed for us. We got back in our car, and Greg said, we're getting ready to pull away, and she came over to the car, and she said, I just want to thank you all again. She said, you folks at Shively Baptist are always coming to my rescue. And I jumped into Greg. I said, well, did you tell her then that you were not from Shively Baptist, but that you were from Shively Christian? And Greg looked back at me, and he said, no. He said, I didn't think it mattered. And I got the lesson on Jesus that night. And it didn't matter. And it doesn't matter. Jesus said, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your church. They may see your good works and glorify your denomination. That they may see your good works and they may glorify your Father who is in heaven. What you believe in your heart will shape how you behave in your life. Do you see how my human tradition had shaped my inaccurate belief? I mistakenly thought that the glory of my church was of greater importance than the glory of God. Lord, forgive me when I lead and act like a Pharisee, when I'm deceived to seek applause for myself or for my church rather than the applause of heaven. While we would never list pride as a human tradition, too often it is the driving force behind most of the traditions that we irrationally hold on to and try to advance. In Colossians chapter 2, verse 8, the Apostle Paul sends a strict warning to one of his churches by saying this. He says, "See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the elemental spiritual forces of this world rather than on Christ." What was true then is still true today. There are some teachings that may have the appearance of being right, but in the end, they leave you sidetracked from God's best. Let's quickly take a look at a third observation, and that is focus your cleanup efforts on what's inside before concentrating on what is outside. The reason people go to treatment centers is in order to stop putting a Band-Aid on a deep-seated struggle or addiction. They realize that they must go deep beneath the surface. They don't focus on cleaning the cobwebs. They try to get rid of the spiders instead. And that's what Jesus is trying to do. He's trying to do a deeper dive. Look in your Bible at verses 14 through 16. Verse 14. "And he called the people to him again, and he said to them, 'Hear me, all of you, and understand, there is nothing outside a person that by going into him can defile him, but the things that come out of a person are what defile him.'" So Jesus is stressing that you have become hypersensitive on the physical more than the spiritual. You are consumed with the exterior more than the interior. You're more focused on your diet than you are your devotion to the divine. Look at verses 17 through 19. "And when he had entered the house and left the people, his disciples asked him about the parable. And he said to them, 'Then are you also without understanding?'" The New International Version says, "Are you so dull?" In other words, are you not thinking? Are you not catching this? "Do you not see that whatever goes into a person from outside cannot defile him, since it enters not his heart, but his stomach, and is expelled?" So Jesus is going to go on and say in the next phrase something that is not found in Matthew's gospel of the same account. And Mark takes us one level deeper, and that's the end of verse 19. "Thus he declared all foods clean." Jesus indicates that food was morally neutral. The problem was not what one ate, but what one did. And food cannot defile a person since it doesn't actually come in contact with one's heart. It merely enters the physical body, passing through the stomach and being eliminated. Jesus is saying true defilement comes from the human heart, not from what somebody eats. And so basically in one line, he changes all of the laws for all of the Jewish people that they have been so fixated on. Look at verse 20 of Mark chapter 7. "And he said, 'What comes out of a person is what defiles him.'" Your words, your actions reveal what is inside of you. Jesus goes on then to go through a long list of what comes out of your hearts. And he goes through a lengthy list. Look at verses 21 through 23. "For from within, out of the heart of man, come evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, coveting, wickedness, deceit, sensuality, envy, slander, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within, and they defile a person." And so the one who created our hearts begins to give a lesson on what comes out of our hearts. And notice that the first half are things that are evil actions. The second half of the list are things that are evil character traits. So he lumps the first half as evil actions. The second half are more traits that we possess. So how would we summarize these 23 verses with all of these complicated concepts and try to understand it in our everyday world in the year 2020? Here's what I'd say. Don't give any human tradition the weight or the importance of biblical truth. Because it's not. I've added some verses on your outline that you can look up that might be of help to you. But it always starts in the mind and in the heart. And we realize a broken spirit and a contrite heart in God's eyes are much more pleasing than legalistic displays designed to impress people with our piety or our spirituality. We just read off this list of all these bad things that come out of our hearts. And to be very honest with you, we don't need a list in the Bible to know that there are bad things that come out of our hearts. We know it because we've experienced it and we realize the poor choices that we've made. Jesus says out loud what we already know. But here's the good news. He offers a new heart. He offers a clean heart. The bottom line is that it is impossible for us to have a clean heart by ourselves. Try as hard as we can. Try to will our way toward a pure heart. We can't do it. It's impossible. Isaiah says that our righteousness is like filthy rags compared to the holiness of God. So God knew our predicament, that we are living from the inside out is the only hope that we have. For God to do a work inside of us, to clean us up through our brokenness, to say, I'll make you into something that I can use. That's why God sent Jesus. And I have good news for you today. When you give him your heart, he will give you his. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we repent of the times when we have made human traditions more important than we should. And we stand solely upon your word. And Lord, we commit to you today that we will do our best to speak where the Bible speaks and to be silent where the Bible is silent. Lord, give us that heart. Change us from the inside out and help us to represent you well. In the powerful name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.